Buenos días a todas y a todos. Tengo el gusto de estar aquí para presentar a dos de las personas galardonadas este año con el Premio Guernica por la Paz y la Reconciliación en su edición 19. Este reconocimiento, como sabréis, lo entrega el Ayuntamiento de Guernica y el Ayuntamiento de Pforzheim, si lo estoy pronunciando bien, coincidiendo con el aniversario del bombardeo de la Vía Vizcaína este año en aniversario. Y es un premio destinado a premiar tanto la labor anónima de personas que trabajan en favor de la paz como a líderes o personalidades e instituciones de gran visibilidad que destacan por facilitar la transformación de los conflictos y sentar las bases de futuros procesos de reconciliación. Cuando miramos hoy hacia Palestina nos cuesta mucho hablar de este futuro proceso. Son más de 200 días de guerra en Gaza. Y en la actualidad nos encontramos con que más de 34.000 personas han sido asesinadas, más de 76.000 heridas y hay 12.000 desaparecidos. Este número equivale al 5% de la población de Gaza. El 2% de la población infantil ha sido asesinada o herida desde el 7 de octubre y se estima que más de 1 millar de niños tienen una o dos de sus piernas amputadas. Todos los adjetivos nos han quedado cortos para describir el horror que está sucediendo y hablamos de una ofensiva sin precedentes, pues durante estos últimos meses han muerto más niños, más periodistas, más personal médico, más personal humanitario que en ningún otro lugar del mundo durante un conflicto. Varios residenciales enteros, lugares de culto, edificios históricos han sido arrasados, borrando siglos de historia de Palestina. Se calcula que hay 26 millones de toneladas de escombros que se tardará años en limpiar. El 75% de la población total de la asediada Gaza ha sido desplazada forzosamente. Las familias se ven obligadas a desplazarse, no una, sino varias veces, en busca de seguridad, seguridad que no pueden encontrar porque en ningún lugar es ni ha sido seguro en Gaza desde el 7 de octubre. Ahora mismo en Rafah, donde Israel lleva semanas anunciando una operación terrestre que parece que se va a producir en los próximos días, UNRWA estima que un total de 1.200.000 personas están sobreviviendo a duras penas en refugios informales, plásticos, en la calle, hacinados y en condiciones nefastas. La organización que represento, UNRWA, es la Agencia de las Naciones Unidas para la Población Refugiada de Palestina. Está siendo la columna vertebral de la operación humanitaria en Gaza. Y no obstante, nuestros equipos se enfrentan a continuos retos y obstáculos para poder entregar la ayuda humanitaria que la población necesita. Las limitaciones de acceso que han impuesto las autoridades israelíes y las dificultades sobre el terreno están obstaculizando este proceso desde el principio. Por ello venimos reclamando que para evitar la hambruna inducida necesitamos un acceso seguro, regular y continuado a toda la franja, incluido el norte. La situación en Cisjordania, que aparece menos en los medios de comunicación, también es extremadamente grave y preocupante. 2023 fue el año más mortífero para las y los palestinos y desde el 7 de octubre la violencia tanto del ejército israelí como de los colonos se ha intensificado. Más de 450 palestinos han sido asesinados, incluyendo a más de 100 niños. Como saben, supongo que la práctica mayoría de los que están aquí, la población palestina lleva 75 años esperando una solución justa y definitiva a su situación. Lleva más de medio siglo bajo ocupación y, en el caso concreto de Gaza, 17 años sometida a un férreo bloqueo por tierra, mar y aire. Lo que ahora mismo está en juego no es solo la vida de las y los palestinos, sino el sistema de Naciones Unidas, tal y como lo conocemos, el sistema internacional de los derechos humanos y el derecho internacional humanitario. En suma, nuestra humanidad es lo que se juega ahora mismo en Gaza. Y en estos tiempos de tanta oscuridad es muy fácil sucumbir al enfado, a la frustración y a la inacción. Pero no obstante, está bien el momento en que iniciativas como la de Combatientes por la Paz cobra aún más sentido. Esta iniciativa nace en 2006 como un movimiento de base de personas israelíes, exmiembros del ejército de Israel y excombatientes palestinos que trabajan juntas con un único objetivo, poner fin al empleo, la opresión y alcanzar la paz. A través de acciones de resistencia civil no violenta, de la educación y del activismo, Combatientes por la Paz persigue la destrucción de los sistemas de opresión para un futuro más libre. y una de las particularidades de esta iniciativa es que fue fundada por combatientes de ambos bandos, de ahí su nombre, Combatientes por la Paz. Es una organización que ha sido nominada al Premio Nobel de la Paz en varias ocasiones y durante casi dos décadas su mensaje ha sido el mismo: no habrá solución al conflicto mientras haya violencia. Hoy nos acompañan aquí dos de sus miembros. Por un lado tenemos a Sulaiman Khatib, codirector y cofundador de Combatientes por la Paz. Sulaiman Nafi pasó sus primeros años en Hisma, cerca de Jerusalén, y desde niño presenció cómo el conflicto afectaba gravemente a su familia y su comunidad, lo que finalmente le llevaría a unirse a la lucha violenta. Pasó 10 años y 5 meses en prisión, donde sufrió torturas y vejaciones, y allí comenzó un viaje de transformación doloroso que poco a poco, a través de la educación, de la lectura, le permitió reconstruir su visión del mundo. Una vez fuera de prisión, en 2005, junto con amigos, comenzó a participar en reuniones secretas con exsoldados israelíes, reuniones que finalmente conducirían a la creación de la organización Combatientes por la Paz en 2006. A mi lado también tengo a Iris Wood, que fue profesora y directora de una escuela en Israel durante muchos años, en una ciudad conservadora, lo que no le hacía cuestionarse el relato legitimador del Estado que ella misma reproducía en las clases. En 2017, su hija pequeña se negó a hacer el servicio militar, que es obligatorio en Israel, y esa fue la chispa para que se empezara a cuestionar su país y la ocupación de Palestina. Hoy en día es una activista por la paz con esta organización y destaca sobre todo la importancia del entendimiento y la comprensión mutua entre los pueblos, empezando por reconocer la visión y el dolor de las personas que hay al otro lado, así como la colaboración entre organizaciones que tienen el mismo objetivo. El camino de esta organización no ha sido fácil, pero sus miembros se mantienen firmes en la premisa de que nadie es libre hasta que todo el mundo sea libre, y en su apuesta por la construcción comunitaria y la lucha no violenta. Bienvenidos, Sulaiman y Iris, y un fuerte aplauso para los dos que nos acompañan aquí.
I grew up with a mother that was Holocaust survivors. The narrative that I grew up with, the message was, remember and don't forget. And I think in the last few months, I'm thinking about it. What is remember, don't forget? And I think that we, the Israeli people, we forgot. We forgot to see the other as human beings. We forgot what is really important, which don't forget. We forgot how to be, we forgot humanity. Something happens to us. So I'm really grateful to be here. I'm taking with me a little hope from you. And I really hope that this crisis that is going on now, it's also a big opportunity. And I really hope that with the help of the international community, it will stop. It will stop. Because no one feels safe. No one. Both sides. No one. Not the Israeli side, which like went back with the drama of the Holocaust. Not the Palestinian side, which are dying, have been killing. Not only in Gaza, also in the West Bank. So I really hope that the international community will stop us. Really.
That we seen about the massacre that happened here almost close to a century ago is the same that's happening right now in Gaza while we're talking, with difference that there is more sophisticated weapons and alive. We can see. People need to see, you know, Picasso and, you know, years later to learn about the massacres that happened here. What happened in Gaza is live, basically, and that's really shocking that these massacres can be allowed again and again. We also seen some pictures that, it is mentioned, you know, that remind of the Holocaust experiences and other traumatic collective experiences that happen again and again. And that shows maybe me and us that this is not necessarily about the Palestinians and Israelis has to fight forever. I know about the Basque people and the culture, and I feel connected to your culture as well as a Palestinian. I feel the struggle is really the same in different places. It's a global struggle for liberation, for freedom, and that's, for me, that's all about. While we're talking about this, I think we talk about also, and that's how I started my journey, talking about my stories. I don't want to go in details about my background, but because it's not about me personally or us personally, not even about Combatants for Peace, which is our movement. It's about really conscious, war of conscience, consciousness now. Globally, I think some people that benefit from the status quo and the system want to continue the system. And people like us that want to extend the system. And I will refer you to a documentary about Combatants for Peace as an example that was made a few years ago that's called Disturbing the Beast. It really can tell the stories of many of us by choosing a few Palestinian Israelis in the movie, that's documentary, is definitely highlighting the human historical questions about narratives, how do we grow up, like Iris explained about a typical Israeli narrative. I grew up with a Palestinian traumatic 48 Nakba, which is happening actually a ceremony. We will have a ceremony for the Nakba in 2 weeks, like in May 15, which I invite you to watch it online. We do it with our Israeli partners, and that's the narrative we're trying to create. As we speak about the past, I think we do have to embrace the past and not forget the past, while not stuck in the past, because the past is also full of nostalgic and trauma, collective trauma, but also it provides us with ancient wisdom. I come from an indigenous family, and that's why I connect with your language and culture that was trying to erase these cultures and thinking there is one way, one culture, one color. And this people are still exist in the world. These ideas are very strong in the world, including in the West, where people think we are free and actually we're not free. Maybe free or moving without visa in Europe, maybe free exporting wars to other nations, but that's not freedom. And actually, I think what's happening in Gaza now is a mirror for the sickness of the global system. And that's what we've seen a few days ago in New York, in Columbia University, in universities, and led in some cases by Jewish activists, actually, Jewish Voice for Peace. And that shows me it's not war between Muslim and Jewish, it's not war between Arab and Jewish, it's not just Palestinian and Israelis. Actually, the other way around, I think the Arab and Jewish has lived together in relatively harmony for 15th century. Talking about the past, there is something to bring out from the past and to be inspired by non-linear thinking of a future, of a different future where all can be free. And that's for me, I personally, just to connect, I started my struggle, armed struggle, when I was 13, 14, as a Palestinian. Not every Palestinian chose to do this, but I come from a very connected Palestinian family that carry also. I want to be honest, it's not I was violent and I became Jesus. That's not my story. We all carry everything. And then one part of my life, as a child, I was drawn to armed struggle, Che Guevara, fighting against colonization. And I still fight against colonization. And this is who I am, this is my truth. I still committed to the freedom of our people. And definitely there is a change in this journey. This was a long journey in jail. I spent 10 years in jail since I was 14. I participated a lot in food hunger strike, which is a non-violent strategy that we do in jail. That's how I got to learn about non-violence. And maybe for you as activist, I see the faces here, the tribe, it's not easy to convince people that non-violence works in front of a big, violent army. My personal experience has taught me that non-violence works. It's a different strategy, it takes long time, and I'm aware the struggle is not for short run. We are here for long run. And then, of course, I studied about Mandela, I was in jail, and was called terrorist, and then was given a Peace Nobel Prize. So, a few years ago, Khin Alon and myself were nominated in the name of Combatants for Peace for the Nobel Peace Prize. We didn't get it, thanks to God. I mean, the idea of terrorist and a fighter, a freedom fighter, is important to think about it. Who's calling what? Who's the terrorist? Who's the villain? And for us in Combatants for Peace, I think we're not a big movement, but I think what we bring is really a questioning the narrative of the status quo, the mainstream. And that's a big thing for us, Palestinians and Israelis. We are facing our own society. I was a hero for Palestinian struggle, and for some people I'm not a hero anymore. And I don't want to be the savior and a hero anyway. I don't believe in a savior. I believe in a collective savior. I believe in a collective conscious. I believe in a collective liberation. And that's what we are working now, actually, in a bigger dream of a collective liberation for Palestinians and Israelis. I don't think there is a way out of the what happened now in the Holy Land. In the Holy Land, again, to say I'm not religious person, but I am inspired by the ideas, the land, the olive trees. For me, is the sacred. That's where I started my struggle as a person that belonged to an ancient family in the land, where the trees, especially olive trees, is very sacred for the Abrahamic families, the Christian, Muslim, Jewish, and our land. And I feel what we did in Cuba Council of Peace is important maybe for other people that think, what can I do as an individual or a group? This is a drop in the ocean, the global system is so strong, I can't change the system. And I just want to mention maybe one or two things that we started 18 years ago, 19 years ago. Combatants for Peace and our alliances, we started something we called Memorial Day, like remembering and a memorial ceremony, which is a national ceremony for Israelis, for example, because, like Chris mentioned, the dehumanization, we just commemorate our heroes and our fighters and our blood, because the others are not human. And we have this tribal system. We had like 100 people in the first year, second year we had 200 people. Last year we had 15,000 people attending our alternative ceremony. We don't call it alternative anymore because this become, I don't want to say mainstream, we are far from this, but become the main Palestinian-Israeli memorial ceremony where we bring Palestinian and Israeli victims of violence, of occupation, of the army, of terrors and so on together to humanize each other and to show empathy and solidarity with each other. This is never happened on ongoing active conflict and occupation. So I think we're trying to bring something from the future and be in touch with the reality now by calling for actively demonstrations for ceasefire in Gaza and the political agreement in Gaza. And the second event is the Nakba ceremony. The Nakba is a Palestinian term, is a Palestinian tragedy in 48. It's celebrated just in the Palestinian side, and for the first time in history that we have our Israeli partners organizing this event with us in the last 5 years, and it's growing, and this year will be May 15, as every year. This is exactly the Israeli Independence Day, by the way. So seeing the narratives is not to legitimize anything, but it's important to see the picture. So you can see it online, you can also sponsor events like this that really embrace life and future. And that's our invitation to all of us.
De tiempo, así que igual la abro al público por si alguien quiere hacer alguna pregunta o algún comentario.
¿Sí?
Thank you so much for having here. So my question is this, that it is all about Israel and the Gaza conflict, definitely. So my question will revolve around the conflict between Gaza children, because I think Israeli IDF already played very well and still they are playing with the distressed and they are still playing with the Gaza children mind, because IDF beat the elders of Gaza on in front of their children. So if children will see him that what happening with their elders, so definitely they will take revenge. There is a two way of take revenge. One is a judicial system and the other one is a gun. The first way is that if they will get justice from the judicial system, then they will not put gun. But if justice system will fail, then they will take gun to take revenge, because what they are they seen and still they are seeing about their elders, because IDF beats a lot of elder citizen of Gaza. So I think children and recent what are happening in Gaza, I don't think so we can bring peace in this area, because those who are still children, they are still facing that what is happening right now. When they will grow up, they definitely will take revenge. So I think this is my question. I hope you will understand what is my perspective.
What is the question?
Sorry?
What is the question?
So my question is this, that IDF are still playing with their mind of Gaza children. They want to convert their children mind toward war, okay, because they are beating their elders.
Okay.
So they are converting their because they want to separate them from the education, because they if they want to take revenge, they will not take education, they will put up gun to take revenge, not book. Thank you.
Okay.
Si hay alguna pregunta más, igual tomamos ahora todas, y digo por el micrófono, así no le hacemos pasear tanto.
Thank you, and thank you for sharing this space with us. And my question is, because if I understood well, that your organization is working with people who were combatants in this war, and I would like to know, how has the experience been, like regarding dealing like with pain and memories, and just like with the recognition. And thank you.
Shalom, salam, thank you so much for what I'm really touched by both of your presentations. And I wanted to ask if we could talk a little bit more about your personal transformations, because we heard some very interesting details, you know, that it was your daughter that kind of ignited the process in you, that it was prison, but also something to do with olive trees and the role of olive trees played in moving from violence to nonviolence. I think I'm very interested in how that human revolution takes place, because, you know, it's very easy, I think, to see the point of the first question about, well, how on earth can people who have witnessed violence, who have experienced trauma, become the people who create peace? But you're, of course, both standing here as the examples of people who experienced trauma, who grew up in this violent circumstance, and who are trying to create something different. So maybe one way of answering the question is to talk a little bit more about how it happened for you. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for sharing. My question is, as far as I can notice, several public politics in Israel are the ones who are causing like the violence between Palestinians and Israels. And the question is it possible to build a public politics that aim to build peace instead of violence? And is it possible for an Israel state or not? Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. To me, as Kurdish people, actually, I want to say I'm very sorry actually to to see what happened today in Gaza and Israel, because as Kurdish people I have many sad experiences about war, discrimination, relocation. So I think when you talk about Israel and Palestinian issue, you have to focus on who behind this situation today we see in Palestine, between Palestine and Israel. First of all, is we have to separate the Palestinian issue with Hamas and Israeli issue with Israeli people with Zionism movement. I do believe this war which happened today is between Israel, of course, actually this war has a historical background, I know about that. But today, this war which happened between Hamas, between Israel and Palestine, I think is not the war between Palestinian people and Israeli people. It's a war, it's a like a proxy war. Unfortunately, I say, since like last one decade, the Hamas is not working like a Palestinian movement. Hamas actually work like a Iranian proxy war, Iranian movement. Unfortunately, the Iranian policy since last decade wanted to export war from Iran to other countries, from Lebanon, from Syria, and also Hamas now is working a movement to support and to fulfill the Iranian hegemonic policy in the Middle East. And also, in another part, Zionism actually makes a war to support the companies who supply weapons in Europe and also in the United States. That's why when we talk about the Palestinian and the Israel war, we have to separate the Zionism with Israeli people and also the Hamas with Palestinian people. But unfortunately, we see some protests in Europe. Sometimes actually they slogan like I feel like anti-Jewish, but actually we have to know that also the Jewish people also are suffering because of this war, like a Palestinian too. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing for us these good ideas and to be that much open-minded. I just want to say that, you know, as a human being, our mind will get used to all the situations we're living in. You know, when you open your eyes every day, every morning, and you'll see a lot of insult attacks and a lot of bad news, you know, a child can get used to this situation and think that, okay, this is life, this is our life during generation. Usually they don't try to change any situation. But when there are such open-minded people in both sides in that part of the land, I don't want to put a name on it, Palestine or Israel, I want to know that how many people in that country are thinking just like you too. And are there any kind of organizations, NGOs, or such things to expand this idea that we can live with peace with each other in this part of lands, and this is not just us having a kind of conflict. You know, many people all around the world were facing a conflict, and they could solve it, they could manage it, and they could transform it to a better life. Is there a kind of thought in the society to give a kind of education to children to think this way?
Sorry, thank you so much for your presentation. I'm really touched too. I don't want to drag more time, just to share, just like it brings up, like the last session that we talked about was art and how art can change and can stop the bullets. So maybe you heard about this point, but anyway, I want to share with the audience as well. It's called Because of Us. It's made by Anne Berry from New Zealand. It says that this morning I learned the English word "cause." Finely woven medical cloth comes from the Arabic word Gazan. Because Gazans have been skilled weavers for centuries, I wonder then how many of our wounds have been dressed because of them, and how many of theirs have been left open because of us. So for me, like, it becomes from art and how, like, the power of the words can also make us think. So thank you.
Hace poco que Elena, gracias por vuestra intervención, y quería dejar una frase que decía Jean Genet, el escritor, que dice que en toda tragedia hay humor. Yo es que quiero unir todo esto, este conflicto con la creatividad. Una forma en mi trabajo, mis trabajos artísticos que he tenido, una parte importante y siempre se recalca que si no hay humor no se va a entender, y hay grandes artistas que han recalcado eso, por ejemplo, uno que dice Chaplin, etcétera, muchos, todos. Entonces, lo que quería, algún testimonio, si tenéis, de algún momento concreto de en todo este conflicto, en toda esta tragedia, si habéis, no, ese momento de humor, quizás, ¿no?, que nos hace saltar por encima de y entender, poder entender que detrás hay una posible solución y vivirlo no de forma tan tensa, o poder saltar eso.
I would start from the first one. Okay.
He was waiting for a long time. You say I'm teacher. You say teacher.
You're right. And it's not. It didn't start in the West, in Gaza. So it's all over the years. When Palestinian children, the only Israelis they will see is or soldier or settlers, which means Jewish people that are living in the occupied territories, and some of them are violent, so they will want to take revenge. It's normal. And the opposite on the Israeli side, when you grow up, when you are afraid from bombs, or when I was a child, I was afraid maybe there is something that I was like taught that if there is something in the street that I don't know what is it, don't go there, it may be a bomb. So if you grow up with these stories,
yeah,
it's normal that you will want revenge. But, this is the big but, you can change it. You can change it. We can change it. And this is what we are doing. And we are not alone. We are not alone. It's a way of thinking. It's the way you speak, the way you act. We can change it. I won't say it's easy, but sometimes, even if we are minority, we can change the future. And I believe in us, all of us. So we can change it. This is my opinion. But the next question, I don't remember what it is. I remember that you want the story behind it, but I don't remember your question.
It's how you've been dealing like with forgiveness and pain.
Okay.
To work together.
Yeah. I think as Chen said, Chen is the co-founder with Suli of Combatants for Peace, and after the massacre at the October 7th, he said that it's we have in our heart, like it's a binational heart. We have in our heart the place for the pain both sides. I think this is the secret. I can tell you, and I will share with you, that after the massacre, the October 7th, my son, one of them, he said, Mom, I can't hear now about the children in Gaza, about the Palestinian children. Don't speak about it now. No, I can't hear it. He lost at the day of the October 7th, he lost three friends. They were murdered at the party, at the Nova party there. And he went to like funeral after funeral, like five of them. And he couldn't bear it. So he asked, Mom, not now. And I think we need to be patient with everyone. We need to give place to everyone. Even to the one that now needs to be with their own pain, the pain of their own people. But all over the years, I think if we want to, we can have in our heart enough place for the pain of both sides. And I think this is the main thing that we are doing with the ceremony in the 12th of May. The common memorial ceremony, the Israeli-Palestine memorial ceremony, is teaching how you can hold in yourself the pain of both sides. How to acknowledge the pain of both sides. And I think, and I know, this is the first step. And I know that most of the people that are coming to take part with Combatants for Peace, the first step was the memorial ceremony. So they learn how to give the place for the pain, not only for one side.
Do you want to add something, or I will continue to the story?
Okay, so for the story, I will make it short. The story was that I was grow up, as I said before, with a Zionist family, what we call, like an Israeli typical family, with a mother which is the Holocaust survivor and father was an officer in the army. And I grew up with a really one narrative. With poems at school, the songs, the ceremonies, everything was really one narrative, the Israeli narrative. We are a little state for the Jewish people, surrounded with enemies. They want to throw us to the sea if they could, and we have to defend ourselves. But during the years, I think something started to crash a little bit. And there was like questions about it, but I must say that I didn't do any effort to really understand what is really going on over there. It was over there, a few kilometers east from my hometown, but over there. And when my youngest daughter came to me and said, Mom, I'm not going to the military, which is a rule in Israel, as you understand, my first reaction was yelling at her, like, how dare you? Your brothers were combatants, your grandfather was an officer in the army, everyone is doing it. How dare you? And when I, as an educated person, as a teacher, I decided to, her mom, I decided to respect her and her willing. And I started a journey with her. And the journey was difficult. It was a journey for me to discover what is it living under occupation. What is it? I discovered occupation. Occupation is not a word that we use in Israel. It doesn't exist. For the average Israeli, the occupation does not exist. So I went to tours with organizations as Breaking the Silence, Combatants for Peace, Women Wage Peace, and I discovered the occupation. And when I saw the reality, I saw the darkness, I saw the evil, and I couldn't go back to my old life. I was the principal in school then. I retired. And I realized that I need to speak up. And I joined Combatants for Peace because I think that if we want to change and to have peace in our region, we must work together. I think I will let you speak.
Did you hear what they said? Israel is taking over, so it's in the blood, what can they do? You spoke about that humor, so... so yeah, I think, so maybe just picking some points that I heard here, not going by order. Firstly, like about your question about the personal, since we started Combatants for Peace, we actually use storytelling and personal story for transformation to pass our message to other people, and it worked. And that's what we're doing over there. So to say two things quickly, one, Combatants for Peace is not just ex-fighters. It's not established by ex-combatants, but then normal people has joined us. So now we have directors, they were not in the jail or army. Also just to say it started by men, mostly. And now I'm really proud to say that we transformed ourselves over the years. And change is not easy. Now our directors are women, like Rana from Bethlehem, Esther, Jerusalem. So also we have a project working with youth called Freedom School, like in both sides, separately and together, for the younger generation. I just want to mention this as a continuation of our work. Now, through the personal story, maybe your question is more like, what theory of change we can adopt and use for everyone? I think there is no one theory of change. I don't believe in this. There are different ways. So in my case, as I said, I am very active since my childhood, basically very connected to the struggle. I play a flute, I also connected with the music because I connected to the Palestinian struggle in the first place through music, basically. And the music was illegal. So I used to have music hidden in my room because it was illegal. Also, I don't want my family to see it because your family, like every family, wants you to obey the system a little bit, so for survival need. And I was not behaving, to say. My school was under Israeli control, so it's not even the education system in my case. My older brother was in jail. I was connected with ex-prisoners and prisoners and so on. Maybe I want to say, like, in jail time, I worked in the library also. Jail is not a peace academy. Jail is really, we used to call it a revolutionary university because we used to have sessions in jail in different organizations, because we are a couple of different organizations. So I used to study a lot also, studied the other conflicts, and I studied Hebrew also in jail. I knew a few words from home because I grew up around Jerusalem. So I studied the multiple narratives of the conflict, to say, even the words I'm using are controversial, to say conflict. Because here it's not two equal sides. It's very important to mention the power dynamic here. So I would say this. I discovered that the power of nonviolence is much stronger than violence. And it takes a lot of patience, a lot of strategic mind. And the second thing, I reached a conclusion, like some of my friends in Combatants of Peace has maybe reached the same conclusion, that there is no military solution, basically. I started with armed struggle for free Palestine, from the river to the sea, and I end up, and still in the journey, for free Palestine, from the river to the sea, for everyone. And that's a big change in my heart, to say the truth. And that's what we are talking about, that we want freedom and liberation and safety for everyone that lived from the river to the sea. And that's triggered a lot of people. And also here we can inspire and bring the Mandela and other experiences of free the oppressed and the oppressor. This is a big other conversation that would trigger people also. How it's not easy, because I'm not coming as a person, despite the victimhood and the trauma and the suffering, I don't have a victimhood mindset. I don't know how. But that's not generally Palestinian, you know, there's a lot of victimhood for real reason. I'm thinking, how do we save, between two practices, people from the evil doing? And I'm not saying I'm on the good side always. That's not true. I struggle like everyone. And triggered always. It's ongoing work that we have to, that's I believe for the activist community is really important to balance the inner work and the outer work. We're not the saviors of the world, which we believe we are. And then that will take me also to some of the comments here, the questions. What do you do with the revenge and the stories that people see now, not in the media, in their eyes, which I've seen for my family too. Of course, like revenge is part of the human culture, maybe. I think two things quickly. One, in South Africa, they did create the Reconciliation Committee. That's inspiring model that we can think about it. That during Mandela time, and this was a very, we're not saying, okay, let's everybody love each other and all good. It's not this naive ideas, but I think there is tools in our culture and in the global culture, universal, that really can deal with the pain, trauma, memories, and all of this. We are not saying to put it aside. I am against shutting part of yourself. I think we should embrace ourselves fully. And that's why I feel able, as a very strong Palestinian identity, I feel very strongly able to open myself up for the other side narrative without giving up my own narrative. And that's not conflicting. It was conflicting for me for a while until I reached this place, and some people can't be there. And I'm aware of that. Like it is mentioned, after October 7, some Israelis went back to the army. For me, this was a black and white decision. If you go back to the violent circle, which is the army, and talk of it, you are not my partner anymore. You go back to your tribe. There are some Palestinians also step back from these circles and said, okay, the only way to deal with the occupation is armed struggle, that's the only way. And this concept is very popular in all sides. I think there are movements, we are a few people. October 8, 9, 10, like, you know, I meet at Bambi Gaza, many, like, how many people stick in our circles? We're a very small group, I have to say. And please remember, we have a lot of conversations, and I do have, we have people personally has been bombed and affected, like, we have people from Gaza and our group also, that their families right now being displaced and starved in Gaza. So it's not like you're talking about academic research. This is real life. I want to mention maybe a concept I grew up with that connected to the Aleph trees, that's what I meant. But it's a Palestinian term, maybe you know it. Asmud. Asmud means steadfastness. And I think indigenous people can relate to this concept, which is basically resilience in the land. That's why it's connected to the trees, the olive trees in our case, in other cultures, maybe other trees. My sister named Sumud, this is not a common name, but it's a common value. We have struggling against colonization. She was born when we were in jail, me and my brother. And for me, this is really a very strong, grounding value in the face of any force. And that's how we stay strong in jail during hunger strike for 16 days. We don't eat 20 days. My longest hunger strike was 17 days with other prisoners. And it's not easy. I'm not talking about it maybe for some people. It's a romantic story, a movie, but it's really harsh moments. You go every day without food, just water and salt. So talking about this, all this and the experiences, in connection to some questions, I know the searching for freedom and liberation is not just a Palestinian story. As the brother here spoke about, the Kurd people, Basque people, everywhere, this struggle is a historical struggle. And that's why, for me, I think what's happening in the land now, like you mentioned there, let's leave the name aside, Israel, Palestine, Canaan, whatever the name, let's say, okay, the Holy Land, is a global struggle for freedom, for justice, and that's what we need to seek for. And there are people, and this is, I end here, at this moment where we are right now, it's really important to keep our heart open to the events, to the atrocities happening in Gaza and West Bank and elsewhere, to stop it, because there is survival need now. And survival need means, you know, people have no shelter, no food, and are not safe. In the same time, I allow myself and my revolutionary dream to use the historical moments now to call for actually the dream of collective liberation, to bring it into real strategy. And this is what we are trying to work on now. And that's not our task alone as combatants of peace or Palestinian Israeli. This is really an invitation for a global coalition, because the global war lovers are working with each other now. The weapon industry, as you mentioned, and we know Mandela, Martin Luther King spoke about it many years ago. If we want to win this battle, the people that love the war work together now. At this moment, exactly, we see that live. And the people that love freedom and peace has to work together to encounter this and to bring into change. And this is the best moment I ever encountered, actually. Thank you.
I have a request. Can I? I know that there are a lot of demonstrations that are calling from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. Did you hear about it? Okay. Do you think that I can go for demonstration like this? Why not? Because I will ask, from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free, and what about me? So, well, my mother was right, you want to throw us to the sea? So, from the river to the sea, there are 14 million people. Most of them are not killers. Most of them, the only thing that they want is to have food on the table, to have a roof above the head, to raise their children safely. 14 million people from the river to the sea, Muslims, Jews, Christians, Israelis, Palestinians. If you want to help us, don't choose a side. Don't choose to be pro-Palestine, don't choose to be pro-Israel. Choose to be pro-peace. Thank you very much.
Pues ahora sí que damos por terminado este espacio. Es que me casco con vuestra presencia y muchísimas gracias a Sulaiman y a Elvis por sus palabras y sus testimonios. Y hasta aquí. Es que me casco.